So that is the way this first half comes to a close. Houston with a 6-3 lead on Washington. We'll be back to Bob Costas after this word from the NFL and a message from your local station.
Daddy, can I have my teddy bear?
Sure, honey. If you take good care of him, he'll take good care of you. Just like when I was growing up, I had an old football that went everywhere with me. I'm Darryl Green of the Washington Redskins, and this is my daughter, Jarrell. I know that every child needs love, a sense of security, especially children who have emotional and physical handicaps. That's why the work of the School for Contemporary Education is so important. Here, children from the National Capital Area are getting the love and special education they so desperately need. These are children who need special education outside of the regular school setting. As a United Way volunteer, I work with children of all ages to help them learn, to teach them to love one another. When we give our love to them, that love comes back manyfold in many ways. Because the United Way, it brings out the best in all of us.
This message furnished by the National Football League.
The West was never so wild.
Look in there.
The good.
Bunch of women.
The bad.
I'm gonna shoot
me.
And the outrageous.
He was so little.
The greatest reunion of Western stars playing the biggest high-stakes game ever.
Oh, get a grip.
A world premiere comedy adventure. The Gambler returns NBC tonight.
It's double time at McDonald's, so you gotta move fast. It's a double deal that just won't last. McDonald's Double Cheeseburger is here. Just as good as before, but now you can buy one with a whole lot more. Fries and Coke, that is. So what are you waiting for? Put on your shoes for $2.99. You can't lose a double patty, fries and Coke. It's big, big news. More for your money. That's McDonald's today. Double time.
Men love the new Ford Explorer because it's one tough vehicle. But it also appeals to the Pharisees because it has push-button on the fly four-wheel drive, more room than any vehicle in its class, and rear anti-lock brakes. So it's perfect for getting to all those important Washington social functions.
Good afternoon, ladies.
See a new Ford Explorer at your local Ford dealer today. If you didn't get a Ford, you didn't get a deal.
Trying to make it 9-0.
Monday at 5.
This is the Domino's Pizza NFL Live Halftime Report, brought to you by Domino's Pizza. Nobody knows like Domino's how you like pizza at home.
Okay, Bob Costas with Will McDonough and Bill Parcells here in the studio in New York. We welcome those of you who watched the first half of the Patriots and the Bills, and of course those of you who've watched the Oilers and the Redskins. It's 6-3 in both games. The Oilers with the lead at RFK. Let's go to the sidelines there and rejoin O.J. Simpson for his thoughts on the first half. Juice?
Well, Bob, you know, out here they were saying that this was going to be the preview of this year's Super Bowl. It was more like the review in the first quarter of last year's Super Bowl with the Redskins keeping the Oilers' high-powered offense off the field. Well, the Oilers made a very interesting adjustment in the second quarter. What Washington was doing is playing a very deep zone. You can't even see their safeties on your TV screen. They're playing so far back. Their linebackers were active at the line of scrimmage. When the ball was snapped, they were running way back. What they were keeping Houston from doing was completing that 20-yard pass to their wide receivers. I think Moon only threw two passes in the whole first half over 20 yards. Well, what Houston did at that point is they started using Lorenzo White. I think he's been the most valuable player in the first half. He made some great blocks, great pickups. And what he started doing was running those little option passes out of the backfield, a couple of screen passes, and that has forced Washington to bring their linebackers up now. So I expect in the second half, Moon will be able to throw the ball 20 yards in, 20 yards out to his wide receivers. So it's up to Washington to make the adjustment now.
OJ, thanks a lot. The second field goal for the Oilers, of course, came after the Lamar Lathan interception. Prior to that, both field goal drives were 17-play affairs. Washington held the ball for 10:36 before Lohmiller connected from 21, then going 81 yards in 17 plays, holding it for 9:38 before Howfield of Houston tied it at 3, and then off the turnover, Houston is able to take the lead 6-3 just before halftime. Bill?
Both teams trying to get something established. Washington, quite obviously, with a running game, and Houston, as O.J. said, with the short pass to the backs. I agree that that Houston did make that adjustment with O.J. that O.J. was talking about, but I don't think Washington is going to change too much. Don't forget, Oilers' high-powered offense. Now, they only have 6 points. Washington's playing pretty just about the way they want to defensively.
Willie?
All year long, people have said, how good is Houston? Well, they always said, how good is the Houston defense? And I think you've seen it here today. They're playing a high-powered team, and they're playing very well.
Yeah, we've heard about Richie Pettibone as the defensive coordinator for the Redskins. Jim Eddy has to be pleased with the work of his group for the Houston Oilers today.
Well, they've done what they had to do in this game, is put a lot of people in the face of Mark Griffin.
All right, let's take a look at some of the other scores from around the league. Both Detroit and Chicago are 6-2. They're tied for the lead in the NFC Central, and it's the Lions with the lead in this game at halftime, 10-3. 20-mile-per-hour winds, below-zero wind chill at Soldier Field. The Lions with the lead by a touchdown in the game. Some of you are watching Buffalo, which has won 15 consecutive games at home and 30 of their last 32 at Rich Stadium, leading by only a score of 6-3 over the Patriots. Now, the Bills average 40 points a game this year at home, but Joe Collier's defense for the Patriots hasn't allowed more than 24 points in any game. And the 3-5 Patriots have been competitive in almost every game they've played, and they're within a field goal at intermission in this one. San Francisco has the lead at Atlanta late in the second quarter, 7-0. Steve Young threw a 97-yard touchdown pass to John Taylor. It's the longest touchdown play from scrimmage in the league this year. He threw it from the end zone. Taylor caught it around the 50 between two defenders, one of whom was the former 49er Tim Maguire. Then Deion Sanders, trailing the play, couldn't catch Taylor from behind. Chris Miller has bruised ribs. He's gone out at quarterback for the Falcons. Billy Joe Tolliver is in, and the Niners lead 7-0. In the Battle of Ohio, Cleveland has the lead at Cincinnati, 14-10. Late in the second, Harold Green, the young running back for the Bengals, 9 carries for 106 yards already. Green Bay and the Jets, a tie just snapped there on an O'Brien touchdown pass to Chris Burkett, so the Jets have the lead, 13-6. And Tampa Bay has a halftime lead at the Metrodome over the Vikings on a 49-yard field goal by Steve Christie. The score there is 3-0 in favor of the Bucks. We're back to talk with Bill Parcells about football superstitions as NFL Live halftime activities continue right after this message from your local stations.
Nobody feels Redskin fever like the Redskin families. What's it like to live with a winning team? Barbara Harrison takes a candid look at the players and the people closest to them. The Redskins on a roll. Tonight at 6 and 11 on News 4.
A special locker room report following the game today.
Which car should I buy?
Plymouth Acclaim?
I need automatic.
Plymouth Acclaim?
Driver's airbag?
Yes.
A good warranty?
You get a choice.
Affordable.
Less than $13,000.
Oh, and air conditioning.
At no charge. Plymouth Acclaim.
Maybe a Plymouth Acclaim.
Nice idea.
Plymouth Acclaim, an intelligent machine.
Go to a dealer. Go to a dealer. Go to a dealer. Go to a dealer.
It's the plays of the month of October on the Sports Machine.
The NFL Live Halftime Report, brought to you by Domino's Pizza. Nobody knows like Domino's how you like pizza at home.
Okay, with Bill Parcells, Bob Costas back at our NFL Live studios in New York. Now, with Halloween still a recent memory, we thought it might be an appropriate time to discuss football and superstition. For all his meticulous attention to detail and hard work, Parcells here incorporated a fair amount of superstition into his coaching. We'll start now by hearing from Bill's former defensive coordinator, now the Browns head coach, Bill Belichick.
In Bill's office, he had a lot of elephants in his office on his desk, and their trunks were all turned a certain way, towards the door, towards the window, I don't know, whatever brought him good luck. And Bill did things routinely, and when those routines worked, then he would stay with them, you know. So if we didn't practice on Saturday and then won the game, you could bank on the fact that next Saturday we wouldn't practice.
I think most coaches and players are like that. They have some kind of superstition.
Oh, I think so. A lot of the players never claimed to have any, but I always noticed that they used to call to my attention the fact that we were digressing from what had been the norm, especially if things were going well. So deep down, we had a few closet guys that had the same superstitions I had.
You know, the only ones that used to bother me, and you'd hear about them in football, baseball, whatever the sport, is when a guy had a certain garment, and he did well, and then he wouldn't wash it. Which is bad enough in baseball where you play every day, but in football where you play week to week, if a guy's going 6-7 weeks, you know, with a pair of socks, I don't care. It's got to change.
Well, we never had those, but we did. We would wear the same stuff, but it was sent to the dry cleaner.
Well, that's reassuring. For more on Bill's penchant for superstition, again, we go back to Bill Belichick.
Who would be the first guy in the locker room, or where he would sit in the locker room, who he stood next to in the national anthem. I think that was a big thing, that when the wrong guy stood to him, he clubbed him over the head and told him to get out of the way because he wasn't supposed to be standing there, you know, stuff like that.
He had a lot on his mind then, during the game.
Bill could keep track of a lot of things, you know, a lot more than I could.
Did you have an assistant in charge of superstitions? You know, a guy with a clipboard, keep track of them?
No, it's just the coaches and the players got to know him. You know, you don't pick up pennies with the heads up. And that sideline thing, for a number of years, I had my captain always stand next to me on the sideline, Harry Carson. He couldn't win a coin toss, so I knew every time I sent him out from there, we were going to lose the toss. You know, we had a little advantage. We could plan ahead.
Step on a crack, you know, break a witch's back. Now, we dug into our archives and found this tape of Parcells talking about yet another of his superstitions.
Cats. Black cats, or cats in general. You know, if they cross in front of you, you can erase them.
Uh-huh.
Do you know how to do that?
No.
Well, you drive your car over where he was, and then you back up, and then you drive back over, then he doesn't count after that.
Well, just to make you feel at home here on the set, between cats and pachyderms, there you go.
Well, you have to point this trunk toward the door. Trunk has to be up, and he has to be facing the door, and that brings you good luck.
Well, with any luck at all, NFL Live halftime activities will continue. Please stay with us.
There's something happening late at night that you should know about.
Abortion, protest,
crime,
environment,
fire,
garbage, gun,
housing,
homeboys,
AKK,
love,
Madonna,
mafia,
MIA,
race,
and
school,
sex,
space,
comedy,
war,
feature,
sport,
weather,
world,
national,
local,
seven
nights a week.
NBC Nightside, news overnight, all night, premieres Monday.
Welcome back to Washington, D.C. Marv Albert with Paul Maguire. Houston leading Washington at the half by the score of 6-3. Now, the Redskins have certainly handled the run and shoot of the Houston Oilers, although they're trailing in the game. But all year long, we've seen the Redskins succeed by making the proper halftime adjustments.
It's going to be the team that wins this game is the one that makes that adjustment at halftime. You keep in mind here that the Redskins are giving up 12 points a game on the average, and Houston 13. Now, one has six, Houston, the other one three. It is that adjustment that has to be made, and that's one thing that we're going to watch closely.
And the Redskins also have been handling the run and shoot by going, for the most part, with the 4-3 alignment. Most unusual.
Yeah, it really is. They believe in their personnel on defense, and everybody's questioning, say, the speed in their secondary. Well, they're not showing it today. They're going in there with five defensive backs, sometimes just three down linemen and three linebackers. But most of the time, they're playing with, even in long situations, third and long, with only two linebackers, and that's great.
Let's take a look at the halftime stats brought to you by Keystone Light. And you can see time of possession. Washington with that long drive that went 17 plays. It took 10 and a half minutes, but Houston able to bounce back, and they had a 17-play drive that led to a field goal.
You know, we talk about some stats, and time of possession really doesn't mean anything unless it's what you do with the time of possession, okay? But when we went into this game, and Marv at the top, when you talked about how close these two teams are together, in time of possession in the game, they're both averaging about 32 minutes a game. Something has to give. Because it comes out to 64.
Yeah, I figured you'd go with the new math to come up with that.
Unless there is an overtime.
Yep,
now it can work
point.
Out.